Windows Me, the unbeloved intermediate Windows release directed at home users, regarded by many as the worst Windows version ever.
Windows Me is the latest version of Windows for the home user.
May it be because it was said to be plagued by overall instability, or the simple reason that it did away with MS-DOS mode, as Microsoft proclaimed to actually increase stability and decrease boot times.
People are doing a lot more with their PC. They're doing digital music, photos. Windows Me even includes the ability to do video editing.
But when Windows Me came along 24 years ago, some clever people found ways to uncover MS-DOS beneath Windows Me and make it functional again. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. Microsoft was working on the next consumer version of Windows in 1999 with the codename Neptune, which should have been based on Windows NT. While it was subject to be released after Windows 2000 to replace Windows 9X entirely, it soon showed that the plan was too ambitious. And so, to fill the gap until Windows XP's release in 2001, Microsoft brought along one last iteration of Windows 9X in September 2000, going by the name of Windows Me. Following requests by many OEMs, whom were allegedly asking for faster cold boot times, Microsoft heavily reworked the underlying MS-DOS 8 in many ways. To improve loading speed, IO.SYS was compressed on disk and decompressed on startup. By including the HiMem.SYS and IfSHub.SYS drivers into IO.SYS along with the boot logo, this reduced the need for external disk reads. Also, pre-reading the Windows registry was optimized, along with a direct call to vmm32.vxt to boot directly into Windows kernel mode. This went along with crippling the processing of config.sys and autoexec.bat, which would completely ignore any configuration statements except set commands. Microsoft went even that far and implemented routines into regenv32.exe, which would parse config.sys and autoexec.bat files and remove everything except the set commands from them on every startup. They claimed that disabling MS-DOS real mode drivers would contribute to better stability.
But how come that Windows Me was shouted at because of its instability?
Well, it seems to be a perception that every second version of Windows is flaky and every other is good. And Windows Me fits well into the flaky schema. I had Windows Me on one of my machines as well, and it was actually quite okay, except for the omission of MS-DOS mode as we can see here. Even under the hood, the usual suspects like the sys and format CLI commands were crippled. The format command was no longer able to create a system disk. Also, sys was no longer capable of transferring the DOS system files from a hard disk onto a floppy disk or vice versa. There was, however, still a GUI option to create a startup floppy, which would include a very minimalistic MS-DOS system, though it would identify itself as Windows Millennium.
But here as well, the sys and format commands were balked. What gives?
And that's when a few people have started investigating into how to restore the MS-DOS functionality in Windows Me. Multiboot.ru has an extensive list of all possible ways and how to do this, be it by extracting certain files from alternate locations or applying patches to the files directly. Rudolf R. Lowe had developed a decompressor utility to uncompress the IO.SYS file to allow for direct patching. Also, a patch tool exists, which applies the patches directly to the files, sparing you the effort to do it yourself with a hex editor. On this web page here, you'll find an extensive drill down into the actual boot procedure and an analysis on what was changed in MS-DOS 8. And for anyone not wanting to follow all this hassle, multiboot.ru offered an ISO image with the extracted and ready to run MS-DOS 8. It's not as sophisticated and feature-rich as CDU's MS-DOS 7.1 ISO image I was mentioning in my previous video, but it does the job. Still, in direct comparison to previous versions of MS-DOS, this particular version of MS-DOS 8 is so much crippled down and stripped of its usefulness that it's actually the worst version of MS-DOS ever. Still, you can try it yourself and start by first taking the sys.com command from MS-DOS 7. But to make it work on MS-DOS 8, you have to bypass the version check with a hex editor first. Only then you can transfer the MS-DOS system files from the floppy onto the hard drive. But these files were not suitable to hard disk booting, at least not without yet another additional patch. Just swapping this double word here from 75 to EB would restore hard disk booting from the floppy disk's IO.SYS when copied over to the hard drive. But even so, you'll end up with this message here asking you to reboot your computer. So you'll have to patch even more bytes in command.com to bypass this check and get into an actual DOS prompt.
But it says something about starting Windows recovery now.
True, so one could patch the string to read something else. And using these patched up files from the floppy disk, you can now also boot into Windows ME. But beware, as you can see here, I ended up in a blue screen. Now, as mentioned before, the hard drive version of IO.SYS loads automatically the included HIMEM and IFSHELP drivers, whereas the floppy disk version of IO.SYS does not. So you need to add it to config.sys to have it loaded from /windows/ifshelp.sys.
Didn't you say MS-DOS 8 didn't process config.sys?
True. But that's not the case for the IO.SYS taken from the startup floppy disk. This one does process the config.sys. Yeah, I know it's confusing. Windows ME obviously came with two sets of IO.SYS and command.com, a crippled one installed onto the hard drive and the less crippled one copied over to the startup floppy disk. But there was even a third version which was also included on the install CD, intended for network-based installs, which was not requiring patching at all. And to make matters worse, there's even a fourth version of IO.SYS that was included on the bootable install CDs. This led people even going as far as to extract the first 2048 bytes from that IO.SYS and swap the first 2048 bytes of the hard disk version of IO.SYS to restore some functionality.
As if it weren't complicated enough already.
Right, and this is where a user called iMic comes in, as he had published a preliminary bundle version which allows to install most of this onto Windows ME using an INF installer. Now, this is quite elegant, as you don't need to worry about all this patching yourself, and iMic explains in great detail what works and what not. But when working with this patch set, I realized I could do some changes and improvements, which you'll find on this GitHub project. For one, I removed the bundled versions of regen32.exe and command.com and added in-place patching of the locally installed files. For the latter, that was important, as I wanted to retain the German localized command.com on my German Windows ME. If only that would be possible with the other files like IO.SYS and pifmgr.dll, where only the English versions exist. And so it's true for sys.com and format.com, which can't be patched up locally as well. The latter I added to the file list myself, as it restores the DOS-based functionality for creating system disks. Of course, that wouldn't justify making a new release, but I also rewrote the INF file a bit to include an uninstall routine so you can easily revert to a default Windows ME from the software control panel. One limitation I ran into, however, was the Windows ME system file protection. I was not yet able to make it work in a way to replace the sys and format commands in the c:\windows\command folder without triggering system file protection to restore the original files right away. One could of course disable SFP from msconfig, but that's less than ideal. No matter what I tried, SFP would always kick in and sabotage me. Now, to make it work, the current release installs the sys and format commands into the c:\windows directory instead, which will take precedence over the command folder because of the path environment priority. I believe I need to investigate into the Windows DDK and SDK how to create a catalog file from the INF file and have it signed, so I can merge it into the Windows default system catalog and have my add-on files treated as regular updates. Anyway, in the end, this all restores MS-DOS functionality for the most in Windows ME and, although only with some extra turnarounds, allows also booting into MS-DOS mode. So, if you're looking for a functional MS-DOS, rather go for MS-DOS 6.22 or the unofficial CDU MS-DOS 7.1, as MS-DOS 8 has also some issues with EMM 386. The patch set includes the IO8 EMMOK.SYS driver, which will fix most of that, but in the end, it's still patchwork. Well, what do you think about this endeavor? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday. Next on the Vintage Collector. So why did I go all the way down into restoring MS-DOS real mode for Windows ME anyway? Simple reason, I was doing a video on the DOS VDM of OS 2 and how it can boot a distinct DOS version off a floppy disk, or a disk image file, or yet even the hard drive, just inside OS 2. And then I suddenly was after the question, can OS 2 also boot into Windows 95?